Also, who didn't say anything, gestured for me to follow her. So I followed her. And we came out of this forest to a hill. But it wasn't a hill. She called it the Hill House. Sort of like what you'd see in The Hobbit. A sod building with a tunnel doorway. It's a traditional Alaska Native house. Of course, this woman had never been to Alaska, so she didn't know what to call any of this. She described the way it smelled, and her description, using different spices from her spice cabinet, is exactly the way the tundra smells in the autumn. There was no way for her to know any of this stuff. Well, there's no way even to research it, but she knew. She said, we went inside, and there was no light but a stone bowl with oil and a little flame. But it was enough. It kept the place warm, and was enough to light the interior of this hill house. Well, it's exactly the kind of stone lamps that we've had for thousands of years. But unless she had taken a very focused anthropological course, there was no way for this lady in upstate New York to know any of these things. Then she laid down and she said, this woman treated me as if I were pregnant and about to give birth, except I wasn't pregnant and I wasn't about to give birth. But all the pain and all the darkness, all the trauma that I felt physically in my body left me. And then she helped me up and we went outside and the aurora was out there. The northern lights were moving around. She said, I'd seen photographs of them, but I didn't know they moved. Well, of course they do. And she served me a kind of tea, and it's exactly Labrador or Tundra tea. She described the way it smelled and the way it tasted accurately. And she says, then this woman started to walk away and I called after her. Who are you? And she answered, something Olga, something garbled, Olga. And that was the end of her vision. Well, it turns out that this lady had as her therapist, Matushka Lynn Breck, Father John Breck's wife. So she went to Matushka Breck and she said, I don't know anything about your church, but is there a Saint Olga? She said, well, of course there's a Saint Olga, Princess of Kiev. So they found some iconographic collection. And she said, no, that's not the Olga I met. Isn't there some other Saint Olga? And it just happened that Lynn Breck was reading Orthodox Alaska, and she said, well, maybe you're talking about Matushka Olga. She said, that's it, what's a Matushka? Consequently, she wrote all this down and sent it to me, asking for a photograph of Matushka Olga. Her letter, however, arrived the day before I was leaving for my only sabbatical ever in Russia. Now, I have photographs of Matushka Olga, but I didn't have time to dig through all my photo albums to find a photograph, so I left without honoring her request. The lady did not give up. She wrote to Kuiflik, Alaska, where Matushka Olga lived, and it turns out that while her husband, Matushka Olga's husband, had been postmaster, her next son and then another son became postmasters. It stayed in the family. And so this letter addressed family of Matushka Olga, Kuiflik, Alaska, came into Teddy, her youngest son's hands. He didn't have time, he was sorting the mail. One of his sisters came into the post office and said, this is addressed to anyone in the family, here you take it. And Agnes took it home. And she read the same story I just told you about this woman in the house and the tea and everything. And as I understand it, Agnes couldn't believe what she was reading. So she sat down and read the letter a second time. And she still couldn't believe it. She read it a third time, and it was as if, she says, her house was filled with the sweet fragrance of incense. This startled her, so she went over to her brother's house. The brother wasn't home, but his wife was. You gotta read this, and when Ivan gets home, make sure he reads it. So his wife read it. Same thing, she couldn't believe what she was reading. Second time, third time, she smelled the incense. She didn't say anything, her husband came home. She handed him the letter. He sat down and read it, and he read it three times also, but he didn't smell anything. But he was visiting a shut-in woman down the street and went to visit her, and when he walked into her house, this woman, the sick woman, said, what's that perfume you're wearing? Are you seeing other women too? Teasing him, right? And so he brought that fragrance with him. Now, I just happened to come to visit the village a little while later, and they showed me this letter, and I said, yeah, I got one like that a year ago myself. They said, what should we do? I said, well, if you have any pictures of your mom with other women, like a police lineup, see if this woman can make a positive ID when she's in a group. So they sent her such a picture, and she immediately identified Matushka Olga, except she said, when I met her, she was younger. Uh-huh. Everybody's younger in paradise. That's good news, isn't it?
Yes. Are they thinner?
And they're thinner. So, now, following this, of course, there have been several other, in Kryzluk alone, there were at least two, one could say, appearances of Matryoshka Olga. One, that following Christmas, when the Christmas star came to the house, the caroler. So we have this custom with Ukrainian or Romanian style Christmas star, except ours twirl. They follow the star into the house, 100 people come. And especially if someone that in that family has passed away, departed this life during the previous year, that family almost always then will have a memorial meal for that person and give away gifts, like the Klingits do at their Kulich, Yupiks do it at Christmas. The following Christmas is when you give away the gifts and have a dinner in your own house in memory of the person who the previous year has died. So they were having a big banquet like that at the house, and people, somebody was taking photographs. No one noticed it at the time, but after the crowd left and the banquet was over, the dinner was over, reviewing the digital photos, Matryoshka Olga was there. Her face glowing with a kind of golden light. And people said there were no lights on that, were no Christmas decorations on that wall. But that you could clearly see her present there during that celebration. Metropolitan Jonakim, a couple summers later, had a panahida at her gravesite. But it was drizzling, the sky was completely overcast, so we went inside the church to finish the service and have a short sermon. And actually, I had the Metropolitan's camera that time. We didn't see anything at the time. But again, reviewing the digital photographs, the entire altar was filled with that same golden light following Matryoshka Olga's memorial. You didn't see it with your own naked eye at the time, but that, and it looked like bright sunshine hitting maybe a brass processional cross. We've had that phenomenon, of course. But that day it was completely overcast. There was no sunshine. This golden light was uncreated. It had to be. It shone out from the altar, despite the fact that it was could not have been reflected from any other source. I was talking to this quite, I would say, providentially, I would say accidentally, but I don't believe this is accidental. I was talking about this, about the, her appearance at Christmas with her great-grandson who never knew her. And he said, that was my camera. Yeah. And I was contemplating suicide. His girlfriend had broken up with him, and he had several, one could say, tragic things happen in his life. And like so many other young Native men, he said, that appearance, he went back to school. This conversation occurred at his wedding to another girl.
That's good.
But it was as if Matryoshka came just to say, no, your life is going in another direction. More recently, I heard of an incident where a husband and wife had separated because of the husband's, I believe, drug use, probably pot smoking. And the wife said, that's enough. I'm going home to my village. You're going to go live with your parents until you straighten out your life. Well, his parents lived in that town made famous by Sarah Palin, Wasilla, 40 miles from Anchorage. So he was with his parents, separated from his wife. The wife back in the village went to the local deacon and said, I'm really distraught about my husband and his problem. And the deacon said, well, we should pray. And he lit a lamp in front of the icon of Matryoshka Olga. Unbeknownst to them, simultaneously, in Wasilla, 150 miles, 200 miles away, the father, the mother, and this young man were sitting in their parlor, and suddenly Matryoshka Olga was there. All three of them saw her, and she was with her husband, Father Nikolai. It's the first time both of them appeared, and it's the first time both of them appeared, not just to one, but in this case, three people. And he didn't know who they were, because he's a younger man, and they've been gone for over 30 years. But the Matryoshka and her husband signaled, and all three of them, the father, the mother, and the young man, got up and followed them into the next room. When they got to the next room, they disappeared. And the son said to his parents, who was that? And they said, well, that was Father Nikolai Michael and Matryoshka Olga Michael. I gotta call my wife. So he called his wife, and the wife said, when did this happen? 5 minutes ago. She said, 5 minutes ago we were praying for you in front of Matryoshka Olga's icon. Now, all of this sounds like the stuff you hear from medieval hagiographies that you find preposterous or too good to believe, or somebody made it up, or But these are all from totally reliable, and in the case of the very first woman, who by the way is Orthodox now and paints icons of Matushka Olga. But I have heard that throughout the country there were more and more appearances of Matushka Olga, particularly to women who have had serious traumas of one kind or another in their lives. If I'm not mistaken, there's at least one parish in Canada where several women were expecting babies, and all of them had miscarriages that year.
Ten.
And how many?
Ten.
Ten?
It was my parish. Oh.
There were that many miscarriages all at once?
Yes.
Ten babies?
Yes.
That year?
That year. The following year, we had about 8 to 10 babies, live, living, right. Growing.
After they prayed to Matushka Olga that year.
And Bishop Serafin was, and intervened, yeah.
So if you believe in coincidence, that's one thing. But I don't think Christians can. These are not coincidences, these are not by accident. And you see, we need to, the Holy Synod needs to, we need to gather these things. Father Andrew is collecting data on Bishop Arseny. And one of the outcomes of his research is, usually in the Orthodox Church, to get someone officially recognized as a saint and a day set aside to commemorate them, to canonize them, to add them to the official list or canon, you need advocates. I mean, that's part of what his research proves, that someone has to say, you know, this guy's been overlooked, we really need to look into this. So I'm thinking, well, we have the Akathist to Matushka Olga, we passed it out in Seattle at the All-American Council. People do know about her, but the stories need to be gathered, promulgated, testified to, and then we can send this to, because I think this is what I'm thinking. Matushka and the others of her generation know this is happening. These are their kids. I somehow envisioned somewhere in heaven they had an elders meeting and they said, our people are in trouble, one of us has to go. and support and encourage and bless them. And the church has enough men already canonized. So they chose Matushka, the Lord approved. And she's the one who's been coming to encourage and bless us. And it is time, don't you think, ladies? All the saints in North America could not all be guys. That's highly unlikely, just judging from church attendance. So that's sort of the update here. You can say, well, the situation is deplorable, it's depressing, we've been beaten down, we've been persecuted. The Aleuts, of course, were taken out of their villages, their houses and homes were ransacked, the churches were desecrated, a fourth of them died during World War II in the internment camps. It doesn't get much bleaker than that. And yet, we're still here, we're persevering, and I would say right now, in certain ways, we're thriving in Alaska. And the quick final chapter here is our latest struggle simply to survive. In the face of the world's largest potential copper gold mine called the Pebble Project. Pebble is a really almost demonic, diabolical, deceitful term. Pebble infers a tiny rock, right? This is the biggest hole in the ground ever made by man. 20 miles long, how many miles deep, and it will be filled with poisoned water. Because to separate the ore, the copper and gold ore from the waste rock, you have to grind it into powder and treat it with cyanide. And then when all this 95% of it is waste, 99% of it is waste, then you can't let that powdered poisoned dust just sit there. It has to be covered with some so it doesn't blow up into the atmosphere. So they put it into what are called mixing ponds. Well, that makes all that water poison. And the Pebble Mine, I marked it with this red blob. The Pebble Mine is upstream from all these Orthodox villages. The red dots are Orthodox villages. So you can imagine how upset our people are about this poisoned water at the headwaters of the world's largest wild salmon fishery. Oh. Now, our diocese 6 years ago passed a unanimous resolution saying, this is sacred land to us. It's not just sacred because the native people have always considered it holy and sacred. It's sacred because God blessed it in the beginning when he made the world. It's sacred because, as we commemorate the baptism of Christ every year, our priests and faithful have been going to all these lakes and rivers invoking God's blessing on it every January. And so, you know, any threat to poison and pollute this water, this aquifer, this whole region, is to us a kind of desecration, and we can't sit silently by. Well, of course, this passed, it's a no-brainer for Orthodox, right? It passed unanimously. We asked the Catholics and the Protestant churches to join. They wouldn't touch it. Too controversial. Probably too many mining people in their parishes. They didn't want to create division where there wasn't any. And so we were the only ones standing up saying, we didn't use the word mine. We just said we could bless any development that would enhance the lives of our people. But we couldn't bless, that's as negative as we got, we couldn't bless any development that threatened to poison and pollute the atmosphere. Because for us, it's sacred, it's holy. And then that following January, Archbishop Benjamin came to personally perform the great blessing of water.
So that -34 degrees.
The videotape of him on the plane, well, you can imagine how happy he was about it. I remember emailing His Eminence and saying, now, Your Eminence, this is a really kind of complicated logistical a process, because we're going to land on a gravel airstrip 5 to 10 miles from the village, so someone's going to have to know exactly when we're landing and come fetch us. They'll bring us to the church where the people, the faithful, will be waiting inside the church, and then we will go with processional cross and banners down to the lake or the river, and someone else will have to be there ahead of time to cut a cruciform hole in the ice and then keep it open so it doesn't refreeze. So I get a message back from His Eminence. Hole in the ice? But this made headlines. Nationally, I would say the National Council of Churches was congratulating. They couldn't get over that the Orthodox had taken a stand on anything like controversial. But for us, that mine represented a threat to the very existence of our villages. And it wasn't an exaggeration to say it was a sacrilege to sit silently by and let that happen. Well, as it turns out, there was then a referendum following that following October, the October 9 months after the Great Blessing of Water, and our people were, the mining people came around to the villages offering between $5,000 and $20,000 to buy their votes. If you vote our way, we'll give you $5,000, and if you get your family to vote our way, we'll give you $20,000 more. These are some of the poorest people in North America. They turned them down flat. And our people passed an ordinance saying, we will not allow, it didn't mention the mine again, because that gets too politically and legally touchy. The referendum was, we will not allow earthen dams higher than 20 feet in our borough. This project needed earthen dams 200 feet. So if the borough passes a law that you can only have 20-foot earthen dams, it puts the kibosh on the whole project. They've appealed this to the Alaska Supreme Court. It's still pending. But we won. And then in the last year, there's a new referendum on the ballot that says, well, what's the real icing on the cake? Pebble Mine was always citing a particular mine here right along this coast in British Columbia where there's a gold mine and a salmon fishery. And they said, see, they're compatible, you can have both. Until their 50-foot earthen dam broke this summer and polluted the entire fishery.
Yep.
So the very evidence that they claim proved that this could happen and it could all be, we'd all be okay. In fact, now this month, that's going to be the breaking of that earthen dam and the poisoning of all those lakes and rivers is going to be the number one commercial from the anti-mine people. So the people in Alaska have gone from something like 8% against the mine to more than 80% against the mine.
Yay.
And Vladika's picture was on the in full color, blessing the hole in the ice. was on the last back page of Alaska Magazine for one full month, and it said someone has to speak up for the water. And it was the Orthodox Church. So pat ourselves on the back. I think we did the right thing. And everyone in Alaska is saying you had the courage to speak up when no one else did. Well, right, but didn't we have the obligation? Those are our villages. And if we weren't going to speak up, who else would? Because we're the only church in those villages. So it really was our moral, ethical obligation to speak up. And speaking up was very unpopular among some groups, but nevertheless it was the right thing to do. And in the end, now the investors in the couple mine have pulled out. 50% of it was owned by Anglo-American in Great Britain. They dropped the project. They bit the bullet. They lost tens of millions of dollars, but they walked away. Tiffany's of New York said, we won't take an ounce of Pebble gold, like black diamonds that people are saying won't touch it. And so they're closing down. The referendum this November says, we will declare this region a permanent salmon fishery reserve, and it will take an act of the state legislature to ever change that. And if that referendum passes this November, it's the nail in the Pebble coffin, so to speak. But it was a David and Goliath battle. They outspent the opposition 5 or 10 to 1. They've got millions and billions of dollars to get their point of view out, but it didn't work because the truth prevailed. And our church, I would say, played probably the critical role in the defeat of that mine. And the, hopefully the preservation of the language, the culture, the ecosystem of our people in southwestern Alaska. So it's there's problems, but there's also great hope, and there's also great energy, and there's also, I would say, well, now with Matushka Olga on our side, great sanctity still working on our behalf.
I'm going to make another little commercial here. I think, you know, sometimes we Orthodox think of people who are, well, there's some kind of creature over there, maybe it's a boat. Sometimes we think of other non-Orthodox Christians as being something not maybe one step removed from witch doctors. And we don't have much use for, I'm very uncomfortable when I'm in a kind of quote-unquote ecumenical situation. But I have to say that when our villages, their culture, our churches, our people were in danger in Alaska, there were other Christians that were willing to stand with us and go to Congress. I went to visit my own Congresswoman, Nancy Pelosi, who was the leader of the House. The first words out of her assistant was, how much money do you have? Because you have to fund everything in Congress with money. And I said, I don't have money, but I've got a bunch of Native people and God. You know what? The Native people and God prevailed in this case. But I was also very impressed and grateful for the willingness of other Christians to stand with us on something that was really, you know, important for us. And I think it's something we need to keep in mind. You know, we don't necessarily have to, sit down and sing Kumbaya. I think it's important that we have respect for others, and that respect sometimes pays off. But I want to thank both Father Michael and a fellow named Mr. Gillum. Gillum, really very, very important in getting the word out. And people all over Alaska, you'll see signs that say Pebble with a circle and a red line through it. That's what that's about.
On bumpers, on windows, on doors, all over the state.
On my miters.
Well, Mr. Gillum, I had never met him. He's a billionaire investment banker, and he came to me. His secretary said, Mr. Gillum wants to meet you. Do you know who he is? I have no idea. Well, we met at my little chapel, and he said, I'm funding the fight against the Pebble Mine, and I've read your resolution. How can we work together? Now, here's a billionaire asking you how we can work together. You know, the temptation is to say, hire me as a consultant for like $1 million, and I'll think about it for a while. But that's not what I said, fortunately. I said, do you have an airplane? Because I was thinking about the great blessing of water, and it's almost impossible to get, those villages are not connected by roads, and to get from one village to the other, you have to hire a plane like hiring a taxi, and it's hundreds of dollars for each stop. So to make this trip that Vladika made, ultimately, it's a $10,000 operation just to get around to all those places. Do you have an airplane? He said, I have 7. Why do you ask? And I told him about the great blessing of water. He said, we can do that. And then 2 weeks before we already had the people lined up to cut the holes in the ice, and the people knew when we were coming. Mr. Gillum called me again, and he said, well, where are you going to stay when you get out there? And I said, well, we're used to this. We go to those villages. They put us up in the clinic or the school or in somebody's house. You know, we'll muddle through. No, no, no. I have a house out there. It's a lodge. Actually, it's a palace. You'll stay at my house, and each day you'll go to the village, and my pilot will fly you back so you can sleep at the lodge.
Oh, wow.
And I'll fly my cook out to cook for you.
Oh.
And so instead of roughing it in sleeping bags on the floor, we had this like 4-star, 5-star hotel kind of accommodation, and Mr. Gillum provided all of that for us.
So the royal family of Kuwait comes out to do a fair.
Okay. Yeah, it's that. And of course, he's fighting the mine too because he loves this area. He's lived there for years. It's his official residence out there. People say, well, he's just doing it to save his lot. Well, that's probably true, but he's also doing it because he loves that land the way we do as well. He has enough money to pick his lodge up and move it to Austria if he wanted to. But really, for him, that's not the issue. The issue is this is a moral issue. A multinational mining company should not be able to come there and simply destroy the land and trample on the culture and the rest. And so, yeah, you know, you're right. We were right, and morally we were right from the very beginning. But if you can't get your message out to the people in the state, and that costs money, you can't win. So Mr. Gillum has spent millions of dollars of his own money. He's the one who's gonna. He told me just last week. We're gonna have every radio, every TV station in Alaska is gonna show that earthen dam collapsing in British Columbia. So when it comes up for a vote about the mine up or down, and of course he's funding all of that, but he's that committed to it. But he credits us, the church, the Orthodox Church, the Diocese of Alaska, for the victory. He said without the collaboration with the church to make this precisely not just an economic issue or a political issue, but a moral issue, an ecological. And by the way, it ties in perfectly with His All Holiness Bartholomew, the Green Patriarch, and his concern for the environment as well. And we had a delegation from the Czech Republic and Slovakia come and echo our pronouncement on the mine as well. So the next step would have been, and Mr. Gillum was ready to do this, to send his private jet to Constantinople and bring the Ecumenical Patriarch to Alaska to have him do the great blessing of water and make this, you know, get the whole Orthodox Church. But it proves that it's overkill. We already won. So we don't need Bartholomew the First. Archbishop Benjamin was enough.
Just remember that coincidence in Italian is going to be.